Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, sir.
So last class we have seen the gross features of the spinal cord, its length and all, how many spinal nerves attached, okay, what are its coverings, okay, what is the basis of doing lumbar puncture, where it ends. Okay, the spinal cord ends at what level, anyone? Anyone? Spinal cord ends at which level? Anyone?
L1.
L1, okay. So, then we saw the processes of pia mater, the ligamentum, denticulatum and all the external features, the spinal segments, the spinal enlargements, the internal structure. The internal structure, we saw the gray matter, the white matter, okay, the anterior posterior horns of gray matter, the lateral horns, okay, and how it differs while we take cross sections between the segments in cervical, thoracic, lumbar and sacral. So these are a little different, okay. Now, so from now, today, we will just, in very short, we will see the nerve cell groups in the gray columns of the spinal cord. Okay, you have, it's not that you have to know each and everything over here, just to have an idea of these nerve cell groups and the laminar architecture. Okay, so for the nerve cell groups, you see, we have already discussed there is the anterior gray horn and posterior horn, isn't it? With in thoracic, thoracolumbar area and as well as S2, S3, S4, there is a lateral horn, isn't it? Now this is for the motor, the anterior horn motor, okay. There are the cells which are thick, as you see it on the microscope, they can be seen very easily. If you compare it, the posterior horn cannot be seen very easily. I mean a little small, the dimensions of the cell little smaller than the anterior one. Now in the anterior again, we can divide the cell groups into lateral, medial and central. Okay, lateral, medial. Now these all are related to the areas where they are getting distributed. Okay, like in the central group, in the cervical areas, there are the nucleus of the phrenic nerve. Okay, there are other nerves, nucleus where they are getting thickened in some areas. So it depends on that. So suppose in the lateral group they are supplying in the, okay, in the lower limb, it's like that. So similarly, if you go in the posterior part, see these things, if you remember, it's okay. I mean, you just have an idea about it, because you won't be able to remember each and everything over here. Just have an idea. So in the posterior part, again you can divide it into substantia gelatinosa. Now this is present in the posterior and all throughout the spinal cord. This is, and this area is for the relay. Okay, this is for the relay. See, this is the posterior horn. This is sensory. So the dorsal, okay, you will just see. See, this is the posterior root, so there is an enlargement. This is the pseudo unipolar ganglion or the dorsal root ganglion, isn't it? That will relay over here. Now, that is the central process and peripheral process. The dorsal root ganglia will be having, this is the central process where it will relay here. There will be a peripheral process where it forms the spinal nerve. Okay, central, peripheral. Now, this central process again divides into different divisions are there. So all these divisions where they relay in the posterior horn of the spinal cord, that will be relayed in an area which is known as the substantia gelatinosa. Okay, present all throughout the spinal cord. Now in some cases, in sensations like proprioception, okay, fine touch, the second order relay will be over the nucleus proprius. Now this is again a nucleus which is occupying just below the, or you can say just anterior to the substantia gelatinosa. So it's named as nucleus proprius. Another column, nucleus dorsalis or Clark's column, we will discuss it when we discuss the ascending pathway. Okay, how some of the neurons of the ascending pathway will relay in the Clark's column. Then this is the visceral afferent nucleus. Okay, then for the lateral horn, there are interomedial and interomediolateral, interomediomedial nucleus. Now this is something which is related to the sympathetic system. Okay, so relaying of thoracolumbar outflow and S2, S3, S4. Okay, in the lateral and the medial respectively. So just if you know the names of it, it's more than enough. Okay, how many groups? Medial in the anterior, 3 groups. Posterior, substantia gelatinosa, nucleus proprius, Clark's column, because these things we'll be discussing about the ascending pathways, and the lateral horn for the sympathetic outflow. Okay, now for the laminar architecture, now this is important in case where you are studying something, where you are doing a research work. Okay, you are suppose you are cutting the dorsal root ganglion or the relay from there, and you are seeing the nerve degeneration in different areas. So in that case, in experimental animals, we have divided these areas into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like that, into 10 areas. This is the laminar architecture of gray matter, also known as the rex laminae. Okay, it's good if you can remember, but it's not must know. So you can again divide into posterior margin. So area 1 is posterior marginal nucleus. Area 2, the substantia gelatinosa, which we discussed over here, is designated as rex lamina 2. Now, if we designate them as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it becomes easier in experiments to look into the area of degeneration, according to the experiment. So that's why we have just, so it's not a must know, but again, you should have an idea about that. Okay. Then 3 is the nucleus proprius. Okay, 4 and 5 is the dorsal column. Okay, 7 is all this, the interomediomedial, interomediolateral. Okay, and the Clark's column, all these are 7, number 7 of rex laminae. Okay, 8 and 9 includes all these nucleus of the anterior horn, and 10 includes the area around the, what is this? Central canal. Okay, so just have an idea about these two things which I have shown you. You have to know the certain terms over here. Okay. Next, now, wait, I mean it is hanged. Next, we will just see about the white matter. So you know all this. There are different types and divisions. Sensory fibers, which are relaying in the posterior horns, having a central process. Okay, from the posterior root ganglia, which I have already said. Okay, and the ascending sensory fibers. These are all sensory fibers. Motor fibers, they are descending. Okay, either they are coming from the cortex. Okay, and then descending from the anterior and lateral horn. Association fibers, which are interconnecting in between them. So these are the different types of fibers. Again, the white matter can be divided into anterior white column, lateral white column, posterior white column. Now this thing I think I have discussed in the last class. So this is the, what is this? Anteromedian fissure. This is the posteromedian sulcus. This is the posterolateral and this is the anterolateral sulcus. So if you go from the anterolateral to posterolateral sulcus like that, from the anterolateral and the posterolateral sulcus like that, so this is the lateral white column. Okay. From the posteromedial sulcus to the posterolateral sulcus, this area becomes the posterior white column. From the anteromedian fissure to the anterolateral sulcus, this area becomes the anterior white column. Okay, so this is the anterior white column, lateral white column, posterior white column. This is how the white matter is divided. Okay, this is about that only. Now, coming to the different tracts of the spinal cord. Now, what are tracts? Tracts are nerve fibers, collection of nerve fibers which are having the same origin, coming from the same area, which are going along in the same course and which are terminating in the same area. So as a whole together we call them as bundle, tracts, okay, lamini, fasciculi. So like that, in spinal cord there are different tracts which are responsible for the motor and sensory functions. Okay, apart from the motor and sensory, so motor will be descending, sensory will be ascending, isn't it? Apart from that, there will be intersegmental tracts. Okay, so if you see the descending tracts, which are motor or efferent, and ascending tracts, which are sensory or afferent, so they are coming from the cerebral cortex. Okay. I think cerebral cortex, is it done? Your cerebral cortex class, is it done for the students? Not yet, no? Huh? Not yet. Okay, so in the cerebral cortex, there are different areas. Some areas are there which are designated areas for motor supply. So the nerve fibers from the cerebral cortex area, they will go and they are responsible for the voluntary action. They will go by the spinal cord. They will traverse the spinal cord. They will, through the spinal nerves, they are distributed to the different skeletal muscles, which controls our voluntary motor movements. Okay, so that command comes from the cerebral cortex, the area of the cerebral cortex. Okay, the motor area, that is known as the motor area of the cerebral cortex. Okay. So those nerve fibers which are coming are known as corticospinal tract. They are coming from the cortex to the spinal cord. So it is corticospinal tract. They are also known as pyramidal tract. Okay, so they are mainly responsible for the voluntary action. Area number. Okay, anyway, forget the area number now. So coming from the cerebral cortex, motor area. Okay. So they are known as corticospinal tracts or pyramidal tracts. So once you think of doing some movement, okay, now it is a millifraction of a second. The moment you think, you can move, isn't it? But that command of movement is coming again from the cerebral cortex through the corticospinal tract. Why you moving depends on what you are thinking or how you are relating the sensory inputs. Okay, that will come from the ascending tracts. Okay, now this is something which is known as the pyramidal tract. Apart from this tract, whatever information is coming from the areas below the cortex, or you can say whatever tracts are there except the motor area of the cerebral cortex is known as extra pyramidal tracts. Okay. The pyramidal tract, again I am repeating, is coming from the motor area of the cerebral cortex, area number 4. Okay, and this is responsible for the voluntary movements. Now the tracts which are extra from these tracts are known as the extra pyramidal tract. Now these tracts will be coming from the other areas other than the motor area of the cerebral cortex. Okay, so there are pyramidal tract and extra pyramidal tract. So these tectospinal tracts, which will be coming from the tectum of the midbrain, the rubrospinal tract, which will be coming from the red nucleus, again in the midbrain, these are all extra pyramidal tracts. So corticospinal is pyramidal. All other tracts which are descending, which are motor, are the extra pyramidal tracts. Okay, for the ascending, these are tracts which are coming from the periphery, which are getting the sensations, which are responsible for collecting the different sensations, okay, and relaying it to the thalamus. Now if you know thalamus, it's a part of brain, okay, it's a part of subcortical nucleus of the brain, which is responsible, or which is the area where the sensory informations are relayed. Okay, each and every sensation except the olfaction has to relay in the thalamus. After it relays in the thalamus, then this other neuron from here will go to the cortex. So ultimately thalamus is a relay station of the sensory areas, Okay, what are these ascending tracts? Spinothalamic tract, the name implies, from the spinal cord to the thalamus. Okay, spinotectal tract. So ultimately it will also relay in the thalamus. Then the some sensation which will go to the cerebellum. Okay, spinocerebellar, anterior spinocerebellar, posterior spinocerebellar. Now these spinocerebellar tracts also will go and relay in the thalamus. After only relaying in the thalamus, they will go to the cortex. Okay, so these are the different tracts, descending and ascending tracts. Now we will see just the major ones one by one. Now the first one we discussed here, the first one which we discussed is the corticospinal or the pyramidal tract, as I have already told you. It's also known as corticonuclear. There are fibers from the pyramidal tract which also relay in the cranial nerve nucleus, so that will be known as corticonuclear. And in some areas in the brainstem, that will be known as corticobulbar. Okay, so you see the origin of the corticospinal tract. This is the representative picture of the cortex. So the origin is the motor area. The origin is the motor area of the cerebral cortex. Okay, from there are some fibers which looks like a crown, known as the corona radiata. Okay, so cerebral motor area of the cerebral cortex, the corona radiata, these fibers will be then collected in a very small space which is known as the internal capsule. Okay, then it will come through an area of the midbrain which is known as the crust cerebri. If you remember, we have discussed already the peduncles of the midbrain. We have discussed about the interpeduncular fossa, isn't it, during the blood supply. What lies in the interpeduncular fossa, anyone? What lies in the interpeduncular fossa? Anyone? Which I have discussed, I have taken the class. Anyone?
Willis.
What Willis? Willis, you are talking about the
circle of Willis.
What? Okay, circle of Willis. Good. So this is the area. These are actually the peduncles. Okay. Again, the peduncles can be divided into different parts. One of them is the crust cerebri. We are talking about the midbrain, the peduncles of the midbrain and the crust cerebri. Okay, so these are the fibers coming from the cortex, corona radiata, internal capsule. They will enter the crust cerebri of the midbrain, which is a part of the peduncle itself in the ventral part. Then in the medulla, they will form, since they are bundles of fibers, they will form an elevation, a surface elevation which looks like a pyramid. So in medulla we call it as pyramids of medulla. Okay, that's why the name of this tract is the pyramidal tract. Okay, then after they reach the medulla, the pyramids of the medulla, there is decussation. There is crossing of the fiber, crossover of the fiber. 75% of them will cross over to the opposite side. Just below the medulla, when it will enter the spinal cord, 75% of them will cross over the opposite side. Now they will form the lateral corticospinal tract. Okay, above this is corticospinal tract going over here. Now below, it is when they divide into a lateral one, where 75% of them will cross in the anterior commissure. Okay, and the rest 20% of them will be still traveling in the as anterior corticospinal tract. So if you see a cross section of the spinal cord, you see we are discussing the tracts. That means we are discussing the white matter here. Okay, so if you discuss the white matter, you see there is an area in the white matter just lateral to the posterior horns, which is the lateral corticospinal tract. These are the crossed pyramidal tracts. Okay, so this one, this pink one, cross lateral corticospinal tract. Then they will relay in the anterior horn of the opposite side, and after that, from the anterior horn, the other neurons will come for they will travel in the respective spinal nerves to supply the skeletal muscles. Okay, similarly, the anterior corticospinal tract, which can be seen over here, it will also relay. Okay, it will also, so it will be crossed and this side will be like that here. So it will again relay with the anterior motor cells of the anterior horn. Okay, after that it will go into distribution for the skeletal muscles. Okay, so this is how. So there is 75 plus 20, how many, how much? 95%. Now rest of the 5%, they will travel in the, they won't cross, they won't cross, they will travel in the same lateral, in the ipsilateral corticospinal tract. Okay, so one corticospinal tract consists of 75% fibers from the opposite side and 5% fibers from the same side. Okay, and the anterior corticospinal tract, 20% of the fibers from the same side. Okay, so this is how. Now this is responsible for the voluntary movements. These fibers are responsible for the voluntary movements. Okay, so there are differences. So this picture might come as a diagram or as an illustration. Okay, in your exam. So here is the location of the lateral corticospinal tract, just medial to the posterior horn. Anterior, okay, just medial to this sulcus, to the fissure. Coming next, see, this is the pyramidal tract which we discussed, is the pyramidal tract. Now all the other tracts which are descending or which are helping in the voluntary movements in other ways, okay, are known as the extrapyramidal tract. Now which the tracts which, sorry, which we will be discussing now will be the extrapyramidal tract. One more thing, you will read in physiology and medicine later on regarding the upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron. Okay, the pyramidal tract, when it is coming from the cortex, it is ending in the spinal cord anterior horns. Okay, so this is corticospinal. Now some of them may come like that and they may end in any of the cranial nerve nucleus. Like here they have shown the oculomotor nerve, trigeminal nerve. Now these are known as corticonuclear fibers. Okay, similarly some of them will end in the other areas of the brain stem. Okay, where they will known as the corticobulbar fibers. Okay, so from here till they come and relay in the anterior horn, this is upper motor neuron. From here till they relay in the nucleus of the any nerve, this is upper motor neuron. Now this nerve, the oculomotor nerve, this nerve, the trigeminal nerve or the spinal nerve, is the lower motor neuron. So this is the concept which you should be knowing. Okay, later on when you have to differentiate between the upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron, palsy and all. Okay, so the spinal nerves and the cranial nerves all are lower motor neuron. The tracts coming from the cortex till them, be it corticospinal, be it corticonuclear, be it corticobulbar, they are upper motor neuron. Okay, now all these tracts which we will be discussing, the descending or the motor tracts, we are now known as the extra pyramidal tracts. The pyramidal tracts helps in the voluntary the conduction of the voluntary movement. The extra pyramidal tracts maintains the tone, maintains the posture of the proximal limb. Okay, maintains the gravity and the anti-gravity muscles. So the function of them is to mainly maintain the proximal part of the movement. Suppose I am moving my hand, so this is the pyramidal tract. For moving my fingers, I have to move my shoulder a little bit. I have to balance my, isn't it, my trunk. So that is something which is this extra pyramidal system is doing. Okay, the work which is extra to the pyramidal system. What are these? Rubrospinal tract, reticulospinal tract, hypothalamospinal tract. There are many more. Okay, we'll just discuss the important ones. Now this rubrospinal, rubro, the name implies it is coming from the red nucleus of the midbrain. Okay, the red nucleus of the midbrain. After it comes, just the area where it arises, it will, just below that it will decussate. And it will travel in the lateral white column. And ultimately it will terminate in the anterior horn cells. Okay, the motor cells of the anterior horn. Okay, so how can be seen? So you can see the rubrospinal tract over here, just anteromedial to the lateral corticospinal tract. And this is an extrapyramidal system, okay, responsible for maintaining the tone of the anti-gravity and the anti-gravity muscles. Okay, next is the reticulospinal tract. Now this reticulospinal tract again can be divided into lateral and medial part. Now it comes from a system which is known as the reticular system. Okay, now this reticular system is nothing but the collection of unnamed nucleuses and unnamed nerve fibers in the whole of the central nervous system, and a little bit of, I mean, the whole of the brain and the part of the spinal cord in the upper part. Okay, so these areas are not named, they are spread like web. Okay, so the appearance is reticular. The nucleus are not named and the fibers are not named. And these are also responsible for the maintaining, I mean, giving inputs as extrapyramidal system. Okay, now this reticular system is having its connection with all the sensory inputs. Okay. And according to the connection, it will give the outputs. So this is a part of extrapyramidal system. They can be divided into lateral and medial. So the lateral one will facilitate the skeletal muscles. The medial one will inhibit the skeletal muscles. Okay. Next is the hypothalamospinal tract. Now this hypothalamospinal tract starts from the hypothalamus. Okay, ends in these areas. T1, L2, S2, S3, S4. Anybody? What does it implies? Anyone? It will be controlling what? If it is T1 to L2 and S2, S3, S4. Anyone? What will it be controlling? This one?
Autonomic nervous system.
The sympathetic system, isn't it? So indirectly the hypothalamus is controlling the sympathetic system. So these are all the extrapyramidal system. Okay, now next, coming to the ascending tracts. Now this ascending tracts are, okay, the first one, the lateral spinothalamic tract, STT. The spinothalamic tract as a whole can be divided into lateral and anterior. Okay, so you see in this picture, this is the this is the lateral spinothalamic tract. Okay, and this is the anterior spinothalamic tract. This is the location. What is their function? The spinothalamic tract, PTT, pain, touch and temperature. They are responsible for giving the sensation of pain, temperature and touch, the crude touch. Okay. Now if we discuss the lateral one is responsible for carrying the sensation of pain and temperature. Okay, now there are, from here we are in when we discuss the sensory inputs, we always discuss in of different orders of sensory neuron. So you see, this is a spinal nerve over here. It's having a dorsal root ganglion, central process, peripheral process. So the peripheral process is carrying the sensation. Now over here it will be pain and temperature. It will be passing through the body, I mean through the, sorry, through the central process. The central process in turn will relay in an area which we have already discussed as substantia gelatinosa. Okay, the area known as substantia gelatinosa somewhere here, when we discuss the different columns of the gray matter. From the substantia gelatinosa, the second order neuron will the substance it will cross to the opposite side. It will cross to the opposite side, okay, and it will continue as the lateral spinothalamic tract. The second order neuron will cross to the opposite side. It will continue as the lateral spinothalamic tract. Then, as I have already told you, it will relay in the thalamus. Which nucleus of the thalamus? Ventroposterolateral, VPL, if you can remember, of course, or otherwise you can just say thalamus. Okay, from the thalamus, the third order neuron will go into the sensory cortex. Now you know that if something is, your pain is there or temperature some, okay, is there. So this is the lateral spinothalamic tract. It will cross after it relays in the substantia gelatinosa. When it crosses, it passes up as lateral spinothalamic tract, relays in the ventroposterior lateral nucleus of the thalamus, and the last neurons will go and relay in the sensory cortex, responsible for pain and temperature. If you see the anterior spinothalamic tract, if you see the anterior spinothalamic tract, what is this? It's not going. See, these things are later on when you relate these things with physiology, okay, then it will appear a little interesting to you, but then again you should know the tracts, these are very important. Okay, theek hai. The anterior spinothalamic tract is responsible for crude touch and pressure. Okay, crude touch and pressure. Now similarly, as earlier, the dorsal root ganglion, now earlier it has entered through the central process. Again in the central process there are two divisions, medial and lateral. The lateral spinothalamic tract entered through the lateral division, now it will enter through the medial division. Okay, again it will relay in the substantia gelatinosa. From the substantia gelatinosa, it will travel, you see this is the anterior spinothalamic tract. So it will travel, it will cross in the anterior commissure. It will travel in the S anterior spinothalamic tract like that. Okay, and again it will relay in the same area of the thalamus, ventroposterolateral nucleus. From there it will relay in the sensory cortex. Okay, so anterior and lateral as a whole, the spinothalamic tract, pain, touch, temperature. Okay, the lateral one, pain and temperature, the anterior one, crude touch and pressure. Next is fasciculus gracilis or and fasciculus cunatus or tract of Gall and Budda. They are responsible for conscious proprioception and 2-point discrimination and vibration. Okay, now the proprioception, the sense of you being in space, the sense of balance can be conscious and subconscious. Okay, now this is responsible, the tract of Gall and Budda is responsible for the conscious proprioception, where you know that you are this balance, you can balance yourself. Okay, and some of them are unconscious, subconscious. The body itself tries to balance it. Okay, so this is being done, these sensations, senses are being carried by the tract of Gall and Budda. They are fasciculus cunatus, fasciculus gracilis. Now again, like that, first order neuron, dorsal root ganglion, okay, central process, medial division. Okay, now they won't relay over here. They won't relay in the gray matter over here, in the posterior horn. In fact, they will form two fascicles over here, two bundles over here, collection of nerve fibers over here, and these will be known as, the lateral one will be known as cunatus, the medial one will be known as, the medial one will be known as gracilis. So fasciculus cunatus and fasciculus gracilis. The cunatus, which is the lateral one, is responsible for the carrying sensation from the thoracic and the cervical segments, the upper part. because as you go in the upper, it will, it has to add it to the lateral side, isn't it? Lower limb ka jitna bhi hai, leg, ye, wo, trunk. After that, the neck part and the upper trunk part and the neck part will be attached. So the cunatus is carrying that. That's why the upper thoracic and cervical sensations from there. So it is lateral. And gracilis is medial. Now they will travel in the respective tracks and relay in an area which is relay in the nucleus, which is present in the medulla in the lower part, known as the nucleus cunatus for the fasciculus cunatus, nucleus gracilis for the fasciculus gracilis. Now from here, within lying within the midbrain, they will cross as internal arcuate fibers and they will reach as medial lemniscus to the same area of the thalamus, ventroposterolateral nucleus of the thalamus. Okay, very simple. They are going as fascicles, I mean bundles, to get relayed in the respective nucleuses, internal arcuate fibers in the midbrain, then travel by crossing as medial lemniscus. They will relay in the thalamus, lastly from the thalamus to the sensory cortex. It's also known as dorsal column medial lemniscal system, responsible for conscious proprioception, two-point tactile discrimination and vibration. Okay, tract of gall and Budda. If you see it over here, you can see fasciculus gracilis, fasciculus cunatus. Okay, we have till now ascending tracts discussed anterior spinothalamic tract, lateral spinothalamic tract and these two. Now we will come to the spinocerebellar tract. Okay, spinocerebellar tracts. Okay, so the spinocerebellar tracts are again posterior and anterior, anterior posterior. Okay, you see again, if you see everything, this is sensory inputs, so they are coming from the dorsal root ganglion. They will be either a central for the central process it will be a medial or lateral division. Okay, now it's entering for the posterior spinocerebellar tract. This one, from the central division, it will relay in an area which is known as Clark's column or the nucleus dorsalis, which we have already seen. Okay, when we were discussing the gray matter. From here, the second order sensory neuron will pass in the same side, and this we will call it as, this area we will call it as posterior spinocerebellar tract, in the lateral most part, or you can say in the lateral white column. Okay, occupying the posterior area of the lateral white column. From there, they will ascend as posterior spinocerebellar tract, and they will through inferior cerebellar peduncle reach the cerebellum. Okay, and they are responsible for proprioception. Okay, balancing, and that is unconscious proprioception. Okay, the anterior spinocerebellar tract, it will relay in the same area, the blue one. It will relay in the same area, the nucleus dorsalis or the Clark's column, but it crosses to the opposite side. It will cross to the opposite side, occupy an area which is just anterior to the posterior spinocerebellar tract, move up, again cross to reach the ipsilateral, the same sided cerebellum, and through the superior cerebellar peduncle, it will relay in the cerebellar cortex for maintaining of the unconscious proprioception. Okay. Now, lastly, it's not going. Lastly, we'll just see the blood supply of the spinal cord. Okay. Now, all the applied important is it's hang here. Good goal, isn't it? Just see. All the applied importances I will be giving, as it's long time I haven't given any assignments. So all the applied importances of these and the previous classes will be given as assignments. ब्लड सप्लाई ऑफ द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड, इसको थोड़ा ठीक ठाक कर लेना बाद में है। ब्लड सप्लाई ऑफ द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड बाय एंटीरियर स्पाइनल आर्टरी विच इज अ सिंगल वन ओके इन द एंटीरियर एस्पेक्ट इन दिस फिशर ओके इंटरमीडियट फिशर द एंटीरियर स्पाइनल आर्टरी इट्स अ ब्रांच कमिंग अप फ्रॉम द वर्टिब्रल आर्टरी फ्रॉम आइदर साइड ओके देन द टू पोस्टीरियर स्पाइनल आर्टरी नाउ दिस यू कैन सी ऑन आइदर साइड देर आर टू पोस्टीरियर स्पाइनल आर्टरी दे आर occupying the posterior lateral sulcus on either side, okay, near the nerve rootlets. It is again a branch coming up from the vertebral artery or posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Okay, now this is responsible for the anterior 2/3 and the posterior one responsible for the posterior 1/3 of the blood supply of the spinal cord. Apart from that, there are segmental arteries which are reinforcing these arteries, the anterior and the posterior spinal arteries. Okay, around 5 in number, which are helping in the blood supply of the spinal cord. Okay, so any doubts? Yes, shall I need to repeat anything? There is no more time, I guess. You can ask me in my WhatsApp number, and I will be giving you some assignments, applied importances related to that. Okay, chalo, thank you.